So A is wrong. It is a virtual image coming from a mirror. And so A and B are not correct. So we have to choose between C and D. C is virtual because it is between you and the mirror. In the first lecture, a number of people chose that. Well, let's see how you answer. The correct answer is D. And this is similar to what we got earlier today. Correct answer is D because the image is behind the mirror and no light can come from there through the mirror. The image is not between you and the mirror, and we can see that in an example of how mirrors work here. Here we have a sort of representation of, I guess, a very thin person with an eye here. And so from their feet, the light bounces off the mirror and reaches their eye like that. From the top of their head, light bounces off like that. So it appears that they are back there. Here's the image of the person standing far away from a mirror. If they move closer to the mirror, their image moves closer to the mirror as well. And you can do that just by angle of incidence equals angle of reflection, as we saw in last week's lecture, and do the ray tracing with your ruler and a pencil. Now, that's true of other systems as well, as we'll see, whether you're looking through water or the mirror, you see images of objects in a particular location. So here we have an object that you're looking at through a mirror. It appears to be over here. That's the image of that object. Now, next time you look in a mirror, ask yourself the following. When you look in a mirror, you see yourself reversed left and right, right? But why don't you see yourself upside down? Well, you have to think in three dimensions now. So let's go to the next magical thing. A prism can create an object, create an image of an object in the following way. We saw last week that when light passes through the prism, and this is two flat surfaces here, and the prism itself is made out of some material with a refractive index greater than the index of refraction in air, which is close to 1. So the light coming, let's say, from the bottom of this object is bent according to Snell's law, and then when it emerges, it's bent again parallel to the incoming light, but shifted from it in position. Likewise, light from the top is bent and then is bent back to its original direction coming out. Light coming straight through the prism, nothing happens to it because it has zero angle of incidence. And Snell's law says that there's no change in the angle when it goes straight through. Great. So how does that make an image? Well, the image, the tree appears to be here, right? It appears to be closer to the backside of this slab of refracting material than it otherwise would. This is exactly the same thing that happens when you stand at the side of a pool and look at the bottom of the pool. The bottom of the pool actually looks higher, closer to you, than it is in reality. And that's why they always paint the numbers on the side of the pool, giving you the actual depth of the pool, because an 8-foot deep pool could appear to be 5 feet deep, and you might be tempted to jump in thinking that it's not over your head, but it can actually be over your head due to this exact effect that we see right here, that the image that you're seeing of the bottom of the pool is closer than where the bottom of the pool really is, and that's due to the pool acting like a rectangular prism. So, what about a thick window pane? Let's do another clicker question. For a very thick window pane, which of the following things is false? A, objects on the other side of the pane appear closer than they really are. B, with your eye close to the surface of the pane, you can see objects around the corner that you otherwise couldn't. C, the higher the index of refraction, the farther away objects on the other side of the pane appear.